If you're like me, having just one of your 3D printers out of commission can ruin your entire day, especially if you know that it's going to take days or even weeks to get the replacement part. That's why in this video, I'm going to be sharing my list of affordable and recommended spare parts to keep on hand at all times so that you never have to let an out-of-service printer collect dust ever again. Plus, I'll be curating a list in the description below of my favorite places to pick these spare parts up affordably. One thing before we get into it too deep, I do have to apologize in advance if this video is a little bit less polished or has a little bit less fancy B-roll and camera angles. And so while I technically am underground, I might have to pause the video anytime rocket sirens go off or run home if my kids wake up. It's a really horrible situation, whatever side of the political spectrum you are on, and it's not a lot of fun. But I hope you guys enjoy this video anyway. Let's dive in. Before we dive in, a quick word on how I chose the items on this list. Yes, in a perfect world, you would have a spare everything on hand at all times so that you could be ready for anything. After all, I love the saying, two is one and one is none. But truthfully, there are many parts on your 3D printer that are unlikely to ever fail in normal course of use. Things like stepper motors, for example, which have a lifespan of 10 to 20,000 hours and rarely ever crap out unexpectedly. Other things like wires, nuts, or bolts can be easily replaced at your local hardware store in a pinch, so I left them off the list. Ultimately, keeping spare parts as an insurance policy does cost money, and that's why on this list you'll only find the things that, from my personal experience, are likely enough to die out on you or break and are also affordable enough that keeping spare parts on hand makes sense both financially and in terms of printing. And of course, the parts which will stop your printer in its tracks if they do. So no cosmetic stuff, of course. And no one part fits that list of descriptors more than this next one, hot end thermistors. Having a functional hot end thermistor is absolutely critical to using your 3D printer. If your machine cannot read the temperature at the hot end, or if that reading is interrupted by, say, an intermittent or wiggly connection, it will shut down immediately to prevent a fire. At least, that's what we hope will happen. Unfortunately, for a part this essential, they also have extremely delicate wires and connectors, which can easily get damaged when you're swapping out nozzles or removing silicone socks to clean your hot end, or even if your hot end gets entangled in a molten plastic monster. Hot end thermistors, whether for your Creality machines, your Prusa, your Voron, or even your Bamboo Lab printers, are incredibly affordable, costing less than a dollar in many cases if you order them in advance and in bulk on somewhere like AliExpress. And for this reason, they top my list of parts that are worth keeping on hand. I like to keep at least two for each of my printers on hand at all times, and I cannot tell you how many times this has saved me from waiting 2 weeks to get a replacement parts. Heating elements. While we're talking about the ever-present threat of molten plastic monsters, let's also add the thermistor's close nearby neighbor, the heating element, to our list. While the heating element is not nearly as delicate as the thermistor, it is no less as essential for successful printing, and I've still had these wires get strained or pulled clean out of the heating cartridge or the tool headboard they're attached to. And once again, whether we're talking about a Prusa, a Voron, a Bamboo Lab printer, or any other one, these heating elements are usually incredibly affordable. For just a few dollars per printer, you can keep a heating element on hand and never have to worry again if you accidentally damage the wires while, say, changing a nozzle. Silicone socks. I hate to harp on the plastic ball monster here, but before we move on to other parts away from the plastic ball monster threat, I do want to mention that silicone socks, as far as I'm concerned, are consumables. They can be damaged by the aforementioned plastic ball monster, or given the heat that they are subjected to every single time you print, the simple act of removing and reinstalling them when you go to replace nozzles can also tear them. On some printers, a silicone sock is less necessary than on others, depending on how the heat break fan is positioned. But it's still a very good idea to keep some of them on hand for each and every one of your printers. Fortunately, unlike most of the items on this list, if you want, you actually can print a mold for a silicone sock and cast your own version if you have high temp silicone on hand, though I usually only do that in a real pinch if I get caught without a professionally manufactured replacement in my closet. Assorted fans. One thing that you can't make at home, however, is fans. Truthfully, you can actually run your 3D printer for a short period of time without things like the part cooling fan or potentially even the power supply fan, though neither of those things are recommended. What you can't do, however, is run it without a heat break fan. And that's a real problem considering that these fans are almost always very specific sizes that you're unlikely to find on the shelf at your local store, at least not in the appropriate voltage. For this reason, if I have a printer that I cannot afford to be out of commission, I always try to take note of exactly which type and size of fan it uses and keep at least one of them on hand at all times. For the Voron Stealth Burner, for example, it's a common 5015 fan. Easy enough. But for things like the Bamboo line of products, it's usually a much rarer type of fan that you're unlikely to find anywhere else. And it might even make sense just to pick up an entire spare hot end assembly like this one, just so you have one at your disposal if you need it. Which leads me to complete hot ends. We've covered the thermistor, the heating element, silicone socks, fans. Why not just keep the entire hot end on hand and be done with it? Well, first of all, yes, that's actually a great idea for many printers. I mean, for the Bamboo Lab X1 or P1 series, a complete hot end is really quite affordable, and it probably makes a lot of sense to just buy an extra complete hot end or set of hot ends, especially if you want to be able to quickly and easily swap nozzle sizes. You could, for example, buy spare hot end assemblies from Bamboo Lab directly in different sizes, or you could pick up this popular aftermarket hot end, which actually allows you to easily swap the nozzle without removing the entire hot end, especially since it comes in packages with plenty of extra thermistors, heater cartridges, and silicone socks. Plus, I think that you'll find for many printers, such as, say, the Prusa Mark III, it's actually equally affordable to find complete replica hot ends online that you can have in case you want to quickly swap everything in case of an emergency, rather than messing around with cleaning up and repairing a damaged hot end. With all that said, stocking a complete replacement hot end is not always feasible. On my Voron machines, for example, which run a Fetus Rapido or a Slice Engineering Mosquito Magnum, the spare hot end could cost $100 or more. For other printers like my Creality K1, full hot ends aren't even available as complete kits. What's more, I still think that it usually makes sense to repair your hot ends and get them back to working order, even if you first do choose to swap in a new one in the meantime so you can keep printing. So ultimately, it's really going to depend on what type of printer or printers you have and how urgently you need to be able to get up and running. For me, personally, I like to keep an assortment of complete hot ends and replacement parts on hand at all times, even though I have plenty of printers to choose from. By the way, speaking of reliable printers that I have to choose from here, and ones that I've been able to keep running at all times, I do need to take a moment to thank the good folks over at Sobel, makers of the SV07 and SV07 Plus, and more recently, their own line of affordable, high-quality 3D printing filament. I've been using Sobel printers and filament in my own print farm here for a while now, and while their products are some of the most affordably priced on the market, I can honestly say that I have never had any significant problems with any of them. The printers exhibit fantastic build quality, they run fully open source versions of software, and they reliably churn out fantastic quality prints with little to no maintenance. So to check out Sobel's line of high quality 3D printing products, visit the link in the description. Doing so not only helps support this channel, but like I said, I can confidently recommend Sobel printers and filament to anyone looking to get into the hobby or just someone who wants to pick up a great printer at an extremely reasonable price. Thanks again to Sobel for sponsoring this part of the video. Up next, let's talk about build plates. Many people don't realize it, but build plates are actually considered a consumable. Over time, they will get scratched up, or in rare occasions, they can actually get torn up, particularly if you're printing extra sticky materials like my personal enemy, PETG, without an interface layer. Not to fear though, because there is an abundance of great build plates on the market today with all different textures and characteristics. You can go high-end and pick up a luxurious wham-bam PEX plate for that beautiful, glossy, smooth finish. Pick up a spare plate from the manufacturer of your printer, or go for the cheap approach and pick up one of a variety of different types of build plates from various sellers on AliExpress if you're looking for something a little different or more affordable. To be honest, I've tested and used the textured build plates on AliExpress on most of my printers, particularly the ones from Fizek, and I've never been disappointed. At under $30 for nearly all common printer sizes, this is cheap insurance in case your original build plate gets torn up. Though, truthfully, I've actually never been able to destroy one of these gold ones myself. But I do have no shortage of damaged OEM build plates, and plus, I'm often so impatient to start the next print that I'll actually remove the build plate and let it cool on the windowsill while I chuck another one into the printer. So either way, it's always good to have spare build plates. Up next on our list, we have Bowden tubes, those Teflon or plastic tubes that guide filament wherever it needs to go. You may not have a printer that uses Bowden tubes, but these things are still endlessly useful to keep around. I use them to route the filament from spool rollers, filament dryers, and AMS units to my various printers, and they also come in handy for supporting wires that you don't want sagging. If you're not using Bowden tubes to guide your filament, you're missing out. With that said, this is another one that is very much a consumable. Over time, filament will wear down those tubes, especially abrasive filament, and removing and reattaching them can also damage the ends. From time to time, you definitely should check on the integrity of your Bowden tubes and replace as needed. Pro tip here, I like to buy these in really long segments, like 1 or 2 meters where possible, so that I have long, uninterrupted pieces in case I want to move an AMS or a filament dryer or a spool roller quite far away from my printer itself. It's honestly really affordable to have this stuff on hand, so you can and should pick up a good amount. Just make sure that you measure the right inner and outer diameter for whatever application you plan to replace. Nozzles. What, you thought that I'd forget about nozzles? More than any other part on your 3D printer, nozzles are considered consumable. Not only do the regular ones wear down over time and extended use, but there are also a variety of different sizes and alloys and specialty functions to suit different materials or projects or purposes. You have nozzles for printing abrasive filaments. You have nozzles for printing out thicker extrusions. You have nozzles for high detail, nozzles for printing at high speed, and of course, everything in between. For this reason, one of the first things I do when I unpack a new 3D printer is check out the nozzle size, length, and threading. Fortunately, most 3D printers on the market today have switched to the V6 diameter and threading, but there are still many different lengths and tip profiles. If I don't already have multiple spares of that type, including 0.4, 0.6, and 0.8 millimeter variants, I immediately order them, generally in both hardened and brass CHT varieties. This means that currently I'm keeping 3 to 5 different nozzle diameters in 2 to 3 different materials and 2 to 3 different lengths, plus volcano adapters in case I want to use a specific nozzle on a high flow volcano printer. Not to mention the specialty nozzles for the Bamboo Lab printers. It's quite a few, but most likely you don't have this many printers, and plus you don't always have to buy the $30 Slice Engineering or Bontech nozzles. While I do use those nozzles for specific abrasives, many of my spare day-to-day nozzles are just AliExpress junk ones, and they generally work fine too. And if you buy those, honestly, they are really, really, really cheap and affordable. As with everything on this list, I'll leave a link in the description to a special kit.co collection where I'll be curating a list of my recommended replacement parts and which stores you can buy them from. We've almost come to the end of the list, but I did want to give you one bonus item, especially after getting such positive responses to my recent air quality video. That bonus is carbon pellets, which, as I mentioned in a prior video, are very good at filtering out VOCs, but expire very quickly when doing so. You may not have a printer like a Bamboo Lab X1 Carbon, Apex Maker X1, or Creality K1 Max, which all ship with built-in carbon pellet cartridges that should be replaced, but you may still want to use a homemade solution such as the Bento Box or Nevermore. And one way or another, there are simple prints available and online to make these cartridges user replaceable so that you can refill your own carbon cartridges using bulk purchase carbon pellets, such as those from Nevermore or Carbon Bulk Sales. A word of warning here, and this is important. You need to make sure that any carbon pellets that you use anywhere near your 3D printers is not acid washed, or you will cause severe corrosion to rails, gears, and pulleys. But yeah, you should be replacing your carbon pellets on a regular basis on any printer you're actually using. That's all for this week. I hope I'm going to be able to continue releasing content regularly. I have no idea what's going to happen, but I really appreciate all of you who reached out and sent positive messages and support and prayers. It really means a lot to me. I'll see you all on the next layer. Oh.